I want to talk a little bit about the most exciting and most recent development in this hypothesis. And so this is addressing the very fundamental dilemma which occurs in coupling quantum fields to gravity. Okay, so we know that in order to describe the laws of fundamental physics, we have to use quantum fields. This is an extremely successful technique, and it's the basis for the standard model. Everything is described by quantum fields in the standard model. However, these quantum fields look like the right-hand picture in the vacuum. And this is just a consequence of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. You might want to set a field to zero and just say there's no electric or magnetic field in space, but this is inconsistent with quantum mechanics. Why? Because the magnetic field is like a coordinate of a particle, x, and the electric field is like the velocity of a particle or its momentum. And the Heisenberg uncertainty principle says that either you measure x or you measure p. You can't measure both. You can't set the position of a particle to zero and its momentum to zero at the same time. You can do one or the other. And so what happens in the quantum vacuum, you might say, okay, let's have zero electric field. But then you've got infinite magnetic field. You might say, okay, zero magnetic field. But then you've got infinite electric field. So the compromise which happens in the vacuum is that neither the electric nor the magnetic fields are zero. They're both oscillating with what is called zero-point fluctuations. So the vacuum is full of these fluctuations, which are pictured in the right-hand side. And these are all the fields in the standard model, the electron fields, the photon fields, the strong force, the weak force, everything is sort of going crazy in the vacuum. I say going crazy advisedly because there's infinite energy in these oscillations. This is a very deep paradox about trying to couple quantum fields to gravity. Now, not only do you get infinite energy in the vacuum, and as I mentioned, gravity detects all energy. And in particular, it's very hard to stop gravity feeling all this energy in the vacuum. So you're led to this immediate paradox that gravity doesn't, is coupling to an infinity and cosmology doesn't really make any sense. So people cheat in various ways. They subtract that infinity in certain ways. But there's a further problem, which is that these zero-point fluctuations in the vacuum spoil this beautiful local scale symmetry of the Maxwell and Dirac theory, which we needed in order to make sense of the Big Bang singularity. So these vacuum fluctuations seem to prevent us describing the Big Bang singularity as a mirror. So what we have done recently, very recently, is we discovered an entirely new mechanism, A, for canceling the energy in the vacuum, mm-hmm. B, for restoring the symmetry of Maxwell and Dirac, the local scale symmetry. And we found we could do that in a very unique way. We call them dimension zero fields. They're rather peculiar fields. They do not have any particles. They merely exist, if you like, in the vacuum. So all they do is sit there and cancel out these various diseases in the vacuum. Okay, so it's, again, extremely minimal addition to the standard model. It's very unique. Their properties are uniquely defined. And then rather miraculously, these same extra ingredient in the vacuum turns out to explain the origin of the density variations. And so this is now rather technical. I'm going to leap to a formula, which I'm not going to justify, but this formula is a direct consequence of the assumptions I've laid out. It says that the power spectrum in the early universe, that's this curly P thing, as a function of wavelength, is given by these numerical factors, which are just a consequence of relativity, quantum mechanics, quantum field theory. Various numbers here, C beta, this alpha Y, alpha 2, and alpha 3 are the strong, weak, and electromagnetic coupling constants as measured in the laboratory. Okay, so roughly speaking, you can say that this is given by defined structure constant, but it's for the strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces. So
sure.
these numbers are all a consequence of the standard model, right? All these funny fractions, a direct consequence of the number of particles of various charges and types in the standard model. So these are all standard model. This number of effective degrees of freedom, this is basically the number of particles in the standard model. So these numbers are just, you know, inescapable consequences of the standard model. This is the red tilt. You see, this power of the fluctuations as a function of wavelength is growing with wavelength, like lambda to this small power. And this small power turns out to be 0.04, which is what we observe in the cosmic microwave sky. Okay, so there is this rather magical formula that comes out of those assumptions. It turns out, and this may be a coincidence, but it's a very tempting one, turns out that this formula matches both the amplitude and the red tilt. So this number gives you roughly 10 to the minus 5. Within a factor of 2, it matches the observations. The red tilt it predicts is 0.042.
Mm-hmm.
Using the CERN measurements of the strong coupling constant, and the observed number from the Planck satellite is 0.041. So this is very tantalizing. All I would say at this point is that I think very few cosmologists are, except us, are convinced by this yet. I'm going around, Latham's going around giving talks, people are challenging us in various ways. If only you could do the calculation this way or that way, or check this or check that, we might believe you. That's very important that we are checked and that we really, you know, present a full-blown calculation to satisfy everyone. And there are various assumptions we've made. They are always the simplest conceivable assumption. But there are some assumptions in this result. If this turns out to be theoretically safe, no one points out a problem with it. If the observations, as they improve, confirm this scaling, you know, extends to even smaller wavelengths, then this will be the explanation, okay? And cosmology will be unified. So, just to close on this, you know, what I've put forward here is the prospect, at least, of an extremely unified picture. There is just the standard model and gravity, perhaps with a few little additions in the vacuum, but no extra particles, no extra forces. And maybe we are actually very close to understand all the physical laws governing the universe and how they describe the Big Bang itself. If this is true, there are many, many other consequences. It leads to a new picture of black holes, which resolves the black hole information paradox. It will lead to many other predictions because it's so constrained, this picture. And there's no wiggle room. I mean, either this picture is right or it's wrong.
If you enjoyed this Toll clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toll Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toll community. You'll also receive my top 10 Tolls. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's Obsession.